good afternoon. I'd like to welcome you all here. I'm so glad that you could make it on this gloomy day. Unfortunately, Dr. Mike McGovern could not make it today, so we do have a very capable stand-in for him. I will introduce him in 1 second. I also want to let you know that there is a microphone in the back so that when we have the question period at the end, please give us just a second to get to you and give you the microphone so that we can record your question as well and so that you can be heard in the room. Our three panelists today begin with Dr. Alan Hicken, who is Ronald and Eileen Weiser Professor of Emerging Democracies and Director of the Weiser Center for Emerging Democracies. He studies political parties, institutions, political economy, and policymaking in developing countries with a focus on Southeast Asia. His book on parties and elections in Thailand and the Philippines, called Building Party Systems in Developing Democracies, was published by Cambridge University Press. He is also the editor of Politics of Modern Southeast Asia, Critical Issues in Modern Politics, and a co-editor of Party and Party System Institutionalization in Asia. His articles have appeared in the American Journal of Political Science, the Journal of Politics, Comparative Political Studies, Journal of East Asian Studies, Asian Survey, and Electoral Studies. Dr. Nick Cheeseman comes to us with a PhD from the Department of Political and Social Change at the Australian National University. His award-winning dissertation on the politics of law and order in Myanmar evolved into his 2015 book, published by Cambridge University Press, called Opposing the Rule of Law, How Myanmar Courts Make Law and Order. Earlier in his career, he worked in Hong Kong with a regional organization aimed at protecting and promoting human rights, convened a People's Tribunal on Food Scarcity and Militarization in Myanmar for a Thailand-based nonprofit group, and lived and worked in a refugee camp. He is currently on an Australian Research Council grant to document where, when, and how torture occurs in Burma and Thailand, and is spending his academic year at the Institute for Advanced Study in Princeton. And finally, Matt Schisler received his MA in International Human Rights Law from Oxford and is currently a doctoral student in the UM Department of Anthropology. He lived in Burma for 8+ years, including 5 years on the Thailand-Myanmar border, where he worked for human rights and media organizations. Several years ago, he co-founded a partnership between the Myanmar ICT for Development Organization and Oxford University that continues until now, as well as set up a working group with activists to influence how Facebook handled online hate speech in Myanmar. Matthew's publications appeared in the Journal of Contemporary Asia, the Southeast Asia-focused blogs New Mandala and Oxford Tea Circle, and in edited volumes from Oxford University Press, the Institute for Southeast Asian Studies in Singapore, and the Australian National University. These are our three panelists. Please welcome them.
Okay, I am a poor substitute for Mike. He asked to be excused. He had a family emergency and wishes he could be here. I am, as many of you know, not a scholar of Myanmar. I was initially supposed to be traffic cop today and making sure that things ran smoothly in our Q&A. But I'm happy to set the table a little bit, drawing heavily on the work of these two fine scholars and Mike's work as well, just to get a sense of what the background to what we're going to be discussing today, and then I'll turn it to the experts to actually talk about the details. First thing I want to note is that the material that they'll be pulling for this roundtable is coming from a special issue of the Journal of Contemporary Asia that should be out in this next year. There's handouts that you can see, and you can see the table of contents of the issue on the table there, if you'd like. They'll be drawing from their own chapters in this volume. Nick has, mm-hmm. Professor Cheeseman has written the introduction, Interpreting Communal Violence in Myanmar, and then a standalone chapter, Myanmar national races came to surpass citizenship and exclude the Rohingya. And then Matt will be talking about his chapter, or drawing on that, Reconciling Contradictions, Buddhist Muslim Violence, Narrative Making and Memory in Myanmar. I thought it might be helpful to start out to actually just note very briefly what the other chapters in this volume look like, so you get a sense of what the breadth of this volume covers. So let me just really quickly note and just give you a sentence or two about what each of these are. Many of these I've had a chance to read. They're already some of them are already online in electronic form. You can take a look at them. We've got The Contentious Politics of Anti-Muslim Scapegoating in Myanmar by Van Klinken and Ong. This is, those of you who know Van Klinken, he's has written one of the books about violence in Indonesia, so it's great to have him sort of commenting from a more comparative perspective here. The material in this chapter looks at how militant Buddhism goes from the concern of a few sort of radical monks and hardliners to a national movement. So how does this thing, which didn't look like it had a lot of followers, suddenly become this nationwide event? One of the things they do in this chapter is reject theories that attribute violence to sort of spontaneous outpourings of hatred in response to specific events, and they instead look at issues of agency, resources, opportunity structure, how those things sort of come together to produce violence. There's also a chapter called Gendered Rumors and the Muslim Scapegoats in Myanmar's Transition by McCarthy and Menninger. This is an ethnographic study of online messaging, so they wade into the cesspool that is Facebook in some cases, they look at the hateful messages that it contains, and particularly they're interested in how this reflects the way in which people ascribe meaning to and come to feel they have a stake in violence and in communities that are actually, in many cases, far removed from their own. So how do they get drawn in and feel like they're actors in or participants in or have a stake in what's going on in violence that is pretty far divorced from them, at least geographically. On McCarthy and Menninger, they're particularly interested in the tropes of the sort of vulnerable Buddhist woman against the threatening Muslim man, and that those images come up again and again and get smuggled in some ways implicitly, often sometimes explicitly, into these online communications. Then we have Chit Win and Keen's article, Communal Conflict in Myanmar, The Legislature's Response, 2012-2015. And as the title suggests, they're looking at the way in which Myanmar's legislature responded to this eruption of violence mainly 2013, 2014 in their case. It's interesting that during this period, Myanmar started its democratic, or its opening, moving sort of down the road towards something more democratic. The junta is still firmly in control, or at least the military is still firmly in control. The USDP, military-backed party, controls all the legislative levers. While they could have responded more strongly to the violence, the USDP does take pretty strong action to prevent the legislature from becoming a platform or a forum for extremist views. So they actually take pretty regular and strong action to suppress debate, to prevent minor parties from using the floor to espouse provocatively communalist views. And so they sort of try and get their minds around and think about what this seeming contradiction. Not sort of strong condemnation, not strong action to try and respond to the violence, but also an attempt to try and mute discussion about this violence within the legislature. Then we've got producing news reporting on Myanmar's Rohingya crisis from Bruden and Verbruggen, which addresses questions of access and news production in the wake of the violence. And particularly, they're interested in the different ways that international and domestic press covered the violence, and the way they justified their choices in coverage. These gentlemen can correct me if I have misrepresented any of these chapters, but one of the definitive volume, I think, on this period of time. So you definitely want to take a look and have an eye out for when it's finally released in print. I want to just take a minute and talk about the sort of scope conditions for what this project's about. What's included in the topic for discussion today, and what at least formally is excluded, although I'm sure it'll come in as part of the question and answer. First, this is a study of communal violence. This is how the authors define, in the introduction, this is how Professor Cheeseman defines this. Communal violence is overtly performed, episodic, recurrent, sporadic, direct physical hostility between self-defining and mutually identifiable ascriptive communities. So that definition suggests a couple of things that are in this, in the scope of this study, and some things that are outside of the scope of the study. So first, what's part of this study is an idea that the other is an existential threat. You have sort of repeated public expressions that fundamental communal common interests of the members of one community are irreconcilable with those of another. So there's a shared belief that one community poses an existential threat. And this idea of threat will come in also in Matt's work as well. Second is this study includes both large-scale communal violence, but also localized communal riots. So we've got everything from a few, single houses burned, or a few, some isolated attacks, to more seemingly coordinated large-scale attacks by one community against another. What's sort of left out, or what's outside the scope of this study, are sort of more studied things like class warfare, the ethnic insurgencies along the borders, armed resistance to the state, whether those be again more isolated or more widespread insurgencies, violence by the state itself. The response by the state in subsequent years to what happens in this period is outside the scope of the study, although, again, I imagine it'll be something that we'll talk about in the Q&A. They also disagree with or want to take pains to emphasize that communal violence doesn't connote a condition in which evenly matched groups sort of engage in a tit-for-tat sort of bloodshed. Where they each bear equal responsibility. They go to pains to stress that the violence in this case is overwhelmingly one-sided, as it often is when we talk about communal violence, and that this is mostly Buddhist on Muslim violence. And then finally, quite interesting, they argue that the causes of the violence are not intrinsic. These are not, there's nothing that comes out of being Buddhist or Muslim that suggests a propensity for violence. There's nothing about the ascriptive characteristics themselves that predict this violence. Often those the assignment of causation, the assignment of what triggered this violence is something that comes after the fact, and they go to pains in this study to not sort of pre-assign or predetermine what those causes, those descriptive differences are and why those lead to violence. Finally, in terms of the second scope condition, this is looking at specifically the 2012 to 2014 period. So they're excluding the more recent communal violence, and they're also excluding the recent state-led violence that led to pictures like this where at least government-backed, if not government-organized, platoons have been attacking and burning down villages, where the government's also been claiming that these are villagers who are burning their own homes in an attempt to bring in a crackdown. Just to be sort of clear about what we're talking about, put a couple maps up here, and we'll leave these here. This is a period of violence or some episodes of communal violence that reached their peak really in 2013 but have their origins in 2012 and spread throughout the country. This is the most intense period is March to July of 2013, and this is a map that shows some of those areas where we had episodes of communal violence. But to give you a sense of the timing, we actually start in 2012 in sort of late summer, early fall, June to October. In the Rakhine state, with several episodes of violence, and then things kind of quiet down until February of 2013 in Butidang. I don't know if I pronounced that correctly, but that's the green spot in February of 2013, and that seems to spark a spreading of this violence. We go from being isolated really to this area to spreading to central and northern, first to central and northern Myanmar, and then to southern Myanmar before coming back to the initial flashpoint. So with that sort of table being set, let me turn the time over to, I think first, Nick, are you going first or Matt? Okay, Matt first and then to Nick.
you guys hear me okay? Thank you, and that was really helpful background news. I am going to use these maps, so I'll leave these up there. And sort of in 2012, actually, just before this violence in Rakhine, I moved from the border on the Thailand side to Rangoon, the old colonial capital kind of near the coast there. And so that's where I was for this whole time period from 2012 to 2015. And I wasn't there as a graduate student yet. So a lot of the observations that became the project that I'll be talking about now, they were kind of an accidental ethnography, as it were. I took a lot of notes and I paid a lot of attention, spent a lot of time hanging out in the tea shops in a poor neighborhood along the Yangon River. So you can kind of imagine the ocean comes up and you get to Rangoon, which is kind of set back from the coast. And I was living in a poor neighborhood there. A lot of people who are dock workers, kind of day laborers, trisha drivers, these kinds of guys. And I'd sit in the tea shop with them in the evenings and drink tea or beer and chat about things. And this specter of fears of Islam would come up in these conversations. And I started paying attention to it, and it was in, I think, March of 2013 in Maitila, which is pretty much smack in the middle of the map over here on the right-hand side for you guys, where there was a really awful massacre. And we didn't know what was happening very much. So we're sort of, everyone in the city in Yangon, everyone that I was speaking to, was trying to figure out what had happened at that point. So 2013, you know, censorship had been lifted, about starting to be lifted at that point, so you could read about things in the news, which was a very new experience. Social media was really starting to flourish at that point, so you could get news on Facebook and things, but you're trying to figure out what's happening. And so everybody in the neighborhood, I came home from work, and everyone in the neighborhood is talking about what had just happened, and there were a lot of worries at that point. Oh, things are happening on other parts of the city in Yangon. And so, you know, it was Victor Turner calls these kinds of moments a kind of social drama, where a lot was bubbling up, and people were talking about what they thought had happened in Maitila, which later we learned was a very one-sided affair and a really awful affair. But at that point, everyone was assuming, and this is a largely Buddhist neighborhood now, assuming that it had been violence that had been instigated by Muslims. Surely they had done something to deserve this, and they were explaining to me all of the reasons why they would believe that, and why they believed that, you know, if Buddhists in Maitila had been doing awful things, well, then it was justified. They were defending themselves in some sense. And that was I have very vivid memories of sitting on the corner and talking about that stuff. And that stuff really has stuck with me. And that was the moment when I started taking a lot of notes and paying attention to the different kind of arguments that were coming up. How would people who hold themselves as Buddhist, who are committed to a peaceful life in most ways that we would understand Buddhism, yet able to justify something like violence? How is someone who, you know, I know to have been a political prisoner at some point during the military regime and released from prison, stated commitments to things like democracy and human rights, yet able to hold these ideas that I think in North America we would call something like Islamophobia? But this is also, you know, isolated to the people, the networks that I was working with, and the neighborhood that I was living in. And so in 2014, I helped set up this project with Oxford and with a local activist organization, where we wanted to understand the ways that people who did have fear that they directed toward Muslims, how did they justify that fear? And I had kind of ideas about that, right, from this accidental ethnography, but I wanted to be open to maybe, you know, being wrong, having misunderstood this, and testing this. So we set up research in six different cities, most of which had been the sites of rioting of different scales. We were in Maitila, we were in Mandalay, which is not marked on this map because this map stops before there was violence in Mandalay, Sitwei, which is over here in Rakhine State, Molamyang down here at the kind of bottom right, and then on this area in the delta on the bottom left where there's no mark because there hasn't been any violence. And so we wanted to talk to people and learn, how do they justify this fear? But I can't go to someone and say, why do you hate Muslims, right? Or why, right? Because I wasn't sure that the terms were defined in terms, was it about religion? Was it something else? I didn't want to assume that the kind of the abductions that I had were the most appropriate terms. So what we set up was, we had a training program for young activists in the city who were then helping us do research and doing research of their own. And we just did what we call the listening project, just to ask people, what are you worried about? What are you worried about in your city? What are you worried about for the whole country? And then what are your hopes? And we just walked people through a kind of brainstorming their kind of top five concerns for their local area and for the country. And that's, for someone who's not used to being interviewed, who's not used to doing research, it's really an odd question to be asked. What are your top five concerns for your city and for the country? So that takes, you know, a half hour to an hour to work through these things. But that's a conversation, the occasion of which, in almost every conversation, concern for violence or concern for the decline of religion came up almost every time. Different ranking, so we didn't do sort of a quantitative study. This was the number three ranking for the whole country. Didn't make a claim like that, but it was a way to have about 70 conversations with people in these six different cities. What were their concerns? The main arguments, you know, for those people who did define a sense of threat, they directed it toward Muslims. And Muslims as Muslims, there were a whole set of arguments that they used to justify sort of a specter of Muslims as a kind of fearsome other. And the important feature, though, that I hadn't realized yet in my conversations in the neighborhood that I was in, but then when I went and looked back through my notes, and I was like, oh, wow, I can't believe I missed this, was the different kind of scales that were at work. So these were not a conversation about Buddhists within the territorial borders of Myanmar concerned about what's a minority. What we learned in the census last year is only about 5% of the population. Buddhists are the overwhelming majority demographically and politically, yet they have this intense fear of Muslims, who are a politically weak and demographically small minority. Mm-hmm. But the scales at work are not limited to within this territorial border. They're a kind of global scale. So the arguments that were made was about Islam as a religion, about the content of Islam. Islam as inherently violent, and these references to textual sources, sort of purported claims about what Islam is as a tradition, illustrations from all over the world. So 2014, 2015 is the time, you know, the last year that I was really doing this research, and ISIS is sort of the watchword on everyone's lips. And this is the example that is being used to prove, well, look at Iraq, look at Syria, this proves the danger of Islam. We don't want Myanmar to be like that. And then practices that are purported to occur within Myanmar but are derived from things that are intrinsic to Islam, things like cow slaughter, which for folks who work in South Asia, who work in other regions where, for example, there's tension between Hindus and Muslims over practices like cow slaughter, this also is replicated in Burma. Things like marriage practices, conversion, the specter of forced conversion, these are all arguments that are circulating and that are connecting all of these different parts of Myanmar. Muslims in any part of the country then can be this potential threat. And so you hear a lot of things of people saying, well, I don't know what this person might do. Or is that person a member of ISIS? And it's a sort of, and this is the classic Islamophobic argument. Islam is unitary and homogenous, and anybody who's a member, a follower of the tradition is then potentially scary. It's also, though, how a minority can seem scary, because the minority is then turned into the vanguard of this global specter. Now, right away, and certainly if you're in these conversations, you may notice parallels to discourses about Islam that are prominent in the United States. And it's good to notice that. The arguments are super similar, and also the material is the same. In another chapter, not one for this edited for this special issue, but actually for an edited volume that Nick edited, I looked at the social media posts that are often circulating, and I noted the way that this stuff is often drawing examples from around the world. So stories about ISIS, stories about something that's happening in Iraq. But not only that, they're drawing English language stories, so things from the BBC, things from the Guardian, Wikipedia pages that are translated into Burmese that are, you know, purporting to prove the point. But there's also some funny translation that happens. The Wikipedia page on Sharia, which is pretty innocuous, gets translated into Burmese, translated, it's not, but it's a Wikipedia link set next to a Burmese explanation of what Sharia is, and this is used to reinforce an argument about that violence that's intrinsic to Islam. But then it gets pretty grim, right? So then anti-Muslim activists from the United States who became super active, especially after 9/11, producing materials that are designed to create fear about Islam, and that stuff then gets translated and used in Burmese. And then some of these anti-Muslim activists from the U.S. going to Myanmar to offer material support to their sort of their brethren who face a risk from Islam, and then that stuff getting picked up and cited by the Myanmar government in its investigations of the issue. So this stuff is all circulating and connected, and that's worth a more extended treatment. But for now, it's also important to point out some of the differences between, you know, Donald Trump's rhetoric or any American politician who builds up a fear of Islam, that stuff would port perfectly to Myanmar. But it has different kinds of valences. So some of the reasons, I think, that this stuff is such a concern, some of the arguments that came up in Burma that are different, that we wouldn't hear here, are arguments about the vulnerability of Buddhism, concern for Buddhism. And this is why I think we're using a word like existential. Now, what does it mean to have an existential threat, right? In my experience in these conversations in Burma, the existential fear is one in which Buddhism could disappear. And that's not, it's not intuitive how that could work if you have a sort of secular religious split in the way that we might understand religion to be separate in the United States. But Buddhism is a religion that relies in as it is practiced in Burma, relies on a vast kind of material infrastructure to persist, to perdure into the future. All Burmese, all Buddhists, if all Buddhists were to die, then in this understanding, there's no longer Buddhism. If all Christians were to die, there's still a sense in which there's a Christian God that exists. But Buddhism as such would no longer exist. Buddhism requires an infrastructure of monks, monasteries, civilians supporting them, texts, training within lineages of a specific textual tradition, Burma being the seat of the best sort of version of Theravada Buddhism. And so the specter of Islam is frightening to in this argument because it kind of gets right at that reproductive engine that is necessary for this infrastructure to exist. So there's all kind of gendered assumptions that come into why Buddhist men need to control who Buddhist women marry and how they raise their children, for sure. But there, it's lent a backing which comes from, well, if Buddhist children are converted, then there's no children to become monks, and the next generation is lost, and this infrastructure begins to winnow away and disappear. Right? So all of these arguments work at the level of a kind of local clash. We're angry about cow slaughter, but it becomes set into a global scale, which is, I think, quite different than the kind of scales that were at issue in something like violence in the colonial era. And we won't talk very much about the sort of historical background of this violence. I would just say that that people who are Muslim have been subject to violence at many different periods in Myanmar's history. But it's not clear to me that the salient boundaries dividing sort of perpetrator and victim, as it were, are defined in religious terms. They're defined, I think, at other times they're defined in different terms, different kinds of scales were the concern. If we go back to the map, right, these kinds of arguments, Islam is inherently dangerous, and anybody then who is Muslim as a potential threat, these are the arguments that connect all of these examples. Now, there are important differences, and we'll hear a bit from Nick about what's happening in Rakhine State a little bit, or Nick will get us to what's happening to Rakhine State, because in Rakhine State, there are people who identify as the Rohingya, which are, if you're familiar with this at all and not a Myanmar person, that's probably the group name that you've come across in the media. But the Rohingya and Islam in Burma are not synonymous. So you have Muslims all over the country who are not Rohingya. So, you know, the top right corner, violence in Lashio, this is actually getting close to the China border, which you can't really see there. There aren't Rohingya, to my knowledge, in Lashio. People who are targeted there are not Rohingya. Yet, rhetorically, violence against them, violence against Rohingya and Rakhine, violence in other parts of the country, this stuff is all woven together. And it's made part and parcel to concern about ISIS. Now, we can talk a little bit about the history, but my concern here is more about memory, about sort of lived experiences that are recollected and then brought up and made relevant in different ways or not made relevant in different ways. And there are two things that I want to say about that before I hand the mic over to Nick. The first is, you know, this, and this is the title that we could take from, the title that is for the article for this special issue is Reconciling Contradictions. So many of the people that we spoke with have memories of neighbors, of friends who are Muslim, and who they've worked together with, who they've spent time with, and this memory does not, or this friendship does not match this specter of a dangerous Muslim. So in that neighborhood that I started out talking about, and a bunch of the guys that I know from that neighborhood, they're day laborers. They're sort of different levels of skill in a labor construction crew, go around the city and do little bits of work. And they're mostly Buddhist, but a few of those guys are Muslim. And now the Buddhist guys in that crew, I've heard all kinds of arguments. They're the guys that I heard, that I started out noticing these awful arguments about Islam. Yet some of their closest buddies are Muslim. And now they don't make these arguments about the danger of Islam when those guys are around. Right, but they're somehow holding this fear, this Buddhism could disappear, and it could disappear because of the dangers of Islam, yet some of our close friends that we work with, our comrades, are Muslim. And so there's a kind of cognitive dissonance there. Now, some people just live with cognitive dissonance, that's fine. But also, some people have to do some interpretive labor, some work, to try to reconcile that stuff. And so I've paid attention to the way that this stuff is reconciled. And all of, in the interviews that we did for the project with Oxford and the Myanmar ICT for Development Organization, MITO, and then in the kind of accidental ethnography in the neighborhood. And people reconciled it in different ways. They could disavow the memory entirely. It wasn't true. Yeah, we were friends before. I just didn't know. I didn't know the dangers of what is happening. And so now I know, and this is disavowed. Or it could be held and say, yes, that memory was true. In fact, we were good friends. However, there is a new, and this is the argument that one of the guys in the crew gave me, there is a new kind of conspiracy. It started with 9/11. And since 9/11, now there is a global Islamist conspiracy that we have to be afraid of. So before, yes, all that stuff is true, but now there's a different kind of concern. Third way, though, is to say something doesn't feel right. There is something unnatural, something not very organic in this kind of paranoia that seems to be overtaking Myanmar about Islam. And so where does that come from? And then this gets us into a political argument. And so I've seen people use their lived experience of friendships and neighborhood relationships to say, wait a minute, I don't trust the propaganda. Who are these political parties? Who are these religious organizations that are promoting this, and who is backing them? And this gets folded into an argument about politics in the kind of transition away from military rule since 2012. A lot of this violence coincides with that transition, and so it gets folded into a discussion of who is behind it. And I think the single most common thing you'll hear in Myanmar after perhaps Islam is a danger to us is, this is some shady dark forces working behind the scenes that are seeking to undermine the National League for Democracy, that are seeking to undermine Aung San Suu Kyi. And if people do that work, then they're able to come a step forward. And so there have been a number of interfaith, anti-hate speech organizations and movements in Myanmar that are working to prevent violence. And knowing different people who are involved in these things, people do them for all kinds of different reasons. But one of the reasons, one of the persuasive reasons, if you're seeking to convince somebody to get involved in these things, one of the arguments that I've seen to be made is an argument about the need to do this, because if we don't do it, the military may come back in power. So the memories lead to a sense of contradiction, and the interpretive labor that's done to reconcile that contradiction is helpful to make the political argument. And you know, as a little side project we did, we looked at four examples where there were almost riots, where everybody in the area thought things were about to explode. The two examples were disputes over cow slaughter. One was a dispute over, you know, some boys outside a beer station got in a fight, and one of the boys got killed in a very poor area. Some of the boys are Muslim, some of the boys are Buddhist, and everyone was worried this would get picked up and taken elsewhere. Another city, someone seemed to be posting on social media and handing out leaflets about how a prominent kind of business person in the city was purchasing weapons, having weapons made actually in a nearby village that's famous for metalworking, and that this was going to be used then to be an attack on that area. So people are sort of actively seeking to foment violence there. And in two of these cases, what we found was the people who work to prevent violence, who aren't sort of, it's not like NGOs who say like, well, we're a peace-building NGO. This is just people from an area who are working to counteract violence. In two of those four cases, some of the arguments they made were about these kinds of memories. So they're using these, they're leveraging these as a way to try to de-escalate things. And they're connecting these things to things like, you know, who will benefit from this violence? We won't benefit from it, but the military party may benefit from it. So that's heartening, right? There are a lot of these memories, and people have memories of friendships, of joining festivals, of working together, and we're doing an oral history project now, collecting these from all over the country, because we think that they're worth holding on to. At the same time, I think there's a concern, and that's what I'll close with. And the concern is that if a key mobilizer for people to get them to work against violence is a sense of this contradiction and a sense of the political connection to this thing, then both of those arguments are vulnerable, right? Memories can be recast, they can be forgotten, they can be connected in different ways. And the political argument, you know, since especially October of last year, when there was, and Alan showed us, I think, the satellite photo of some of these attacks, where there was an attack by an organization which is said to be funded from Pakistan and Saudi Arabia. It's a terrorist organization, and the Myanmar government's response has been brutal, and they've justified that response in counterterrorism terms. Now, in counterterrorism terms gets folded in again into this argument about Islam. It has nothing to do with Rohingya per se. It's about the specter of a global terrorist threat now on Myanmar soil. But the thing that's worrisome is that's under the NLD government. Now, the NLD doesn't have formal control over the military who's implementing these operations. Nonetheless, the NLD's willingness to make an argument about counterterrorism concerns means that I think we need to be concerned that if over the next few years, if an NLD government ceases to seem like it is opposed to these narratives, right? If there's not a connection, if the dark forces seem to be aligned with the NLD, if there's no longer a concern that these dark forces are using anti-Muslim propaganda to undermine the NLD because the NLD doesn't seem to mind the anti-Muslim propaganda, then I think you've removed maybe the central motivation for many people to participate in work to prevent violence. We've had a lot of violence, but we've had not nearly as much violence as there could be. And you know, we hope that people keep mobilizing and sort of making sure that these little moments that could become very violent fail. But in order to do that work, you need to have arguments, you need to have sort of semiotic cultural material that you can draw upon. And I think that the things that are available, that have been available for us, this research has helped me kind of see how they work together. I think looking forward, we may see some of that stuff decline in salience and persuasive power, and I think that's something we should be worried about. But it's about 20 minutes for me, so I'll hand over to Nick.
Get the lights up, is it possible to, because I won't be using the screen at all, and I'm pretending that I don't need glasses, even though I'm starting to get the sense otherwise. Thank you very much. So thank you very much also to colleagues for organizing this event at the University of Michigan. It's a great pleasure to be here again. It's my second occasion to visit. And especially to Professor Hicken standing in and taking responsibility for our panel. As Professor Hicken has been kind enough to speak already about the overall contents of the forthcoming issue of the Journal of Contemporary Asia on which the presentations today are based and around which the panel is formed, I've had the opportunity to say a few words on my specific contribution, which concerns the political idea, or the political problem, from my point of view, of national races, or in Burmese, dayinta, and I'll use the two terms interchangeably today. I argue that dayinta is among the preeminent political ideas in Myanmar today, and also that it's intimate to the communal violence with which we're concerned in this panel discussion. So what is dayinta and why is it a problem? For some years I was troubled living in and researching Myanmar by its recurrence, indeed its ubiquity, in the language of political discourse there. However, because the term is translated into English inconsistently, and because its usage is highly contingent, its peculiar significance for political speech and action in Myanmar seems to be lost, or somewhat obscured at least, in research done by people coming to study the country from abroad and writing in English. So my initial inclination was at least to just write a piece to draw attention towards this political idea and its significance in the Burmese lexicon. But as I worked on the piece, I began to think much more about not only the question of translation, as it were, but also how to reinterpret the political idea of dayinta. And to do that, I deliberately decided to set aside the conventional interpretation of dayinta offered by other researchers who have paid attention to it at all, who are relatively few in number, and that is as a synonym for race or ethnicity or indigeneity. And I sought to reconceptualize it by concentrating on its function as an exemplary term of state, as a contrivance for political inclusion and exclusion, for political eligibility and domination. My argument, in brief, is that both lexically and legally, in today's Myanmar, the idea of national races precedes and surpasses citizenship. The distinctive national races truth regime, with a nod to Foucault, of course, is the primary domain for the production and ordering of what constitutes truth and falsity on the question of the membership in the political community that is Myanmar. By virtue of this truth regime, to talk of this political community is to talk of dayinta, and to talk to that community is above all to address its members as members of national races. I worked towards this position via an historical genealogical method. The method seemed to me to recommend itself for study of Dayantha because of its emphasis on the denaturalizing of accepted ideas and with pointing to ambiguity, contingency, and uncertainty that adhere to human activities and our interpretations of them. So concentrating on significant episodes of growth, development, and change in the term since the colonial period up to the present, I use the genealogical method to show how Dayantha went from being an idea of small political significance a century ago to become the preeminent political term of state that it is in the present. I identify 1964 as a pivotal year in which the then military dictator General Ne Win grasped the idea of Dayantha with unprecedented enthusiasm and led thereby to the establishment of a whole series of new institutions, the writing of new publications that laid the foundations for the truth regime of the present. The project on which the idea was built also meshed with a larger program at that time for political domination and exclusion through the nationalization of assets and deportation of alleged aliens. And it got a fillip in 1988, 1989, with the return of the military to the center of politics in Myanmar and the cementing of the idea of national races into its three main national causes. Alongside the genealogical work that I did on the national races idea, I also explored the emergence of taxonomic arrangements for the ordering of knowledge of beings designated as Dayantha, such that today we have 135 categories of persons who are represented in a schema for the promotion of this particular form of truth. The taxonomy, which only became a part of the national races truth regime in the 1990s, is highly unstable. It has no coherent logical basis or formal criteria, and in fact, its formulation remains a mystery. In 2013, when a deputy minister was asked about who produced this list of 135 national races, he had to refer to a newspaper article which didn't provide much clarification with regards to the details of how the list was produced. In any event, the list does not include a category Rohingya. And that fact is significant because the notion of national race is today folded into or translated into de jure and de facto arrangements for citizenship, and especially it is folded into them via the application and misapplication, as it were, of the 1982 citizenship law. Now, for those of you who have followed the news on this topic, you very often hear in news reports statements to the effect that the 1982 citizenship law stripped Rohingya of citizenship and identified 135 ethnic groups that are part of the national polity, not including them. In fact, the law contains no reference to the official taxonomy of national race groups, nor does it contain any specific sections to deny Rohingya citizenship. What it does do is make membership in a national race the gold standard for citizenship and the primary basis for determining the rights of someone claiming to be a member of the political community Myanmar. It achieved this result, in brief, by stipulating that a person's status as a member of a national race or not preceded and significantly determined their status as a citizen. It's not the only basis for citizenship, but it is the primary one. And in making that move, in fact, the 1982 law inverted or reversed the arrangements of the prior citizenship law of 1948. Importantly, for hundreds of thousands of people who might not be classed as Dayantha, the law provided that nobody who already had citizenship would lose it. So this provision should have functioned to prevent large-scale statelessness by enabling existing citizens to transfer over to the new regime without having to provide new evidence in support of their claims. Present your old identity card, obtain a new one. That's all it should have taken. But it is at this point that we move from questions around the law's contents to the circumstances of its drafting, application, and implementation. So although the 1982 citizenship law attracted a lot of attention during its drafting, once it actually passed into law, it wasn't immediately implemented. Only after some years did authorities officially begin issuing new identity cards distinguished as a pink card, as against the pre-1982 green cards, which A holder in the pink card is identified by entries indicating whether they are or are not a member of one or more national races. It's a feature of the green cards, that feature that the green cards did not have in contrast to the pink cards. In any case, the work on introducing the new citizenship regime appears to have gone on somewhat lethargically and without fanfare. But the year after the new military regime took over in 1988 and it reasserted the significance of Dayantar as the preeminent term of state, it started vigorously enforcing the law and demanding that people carry the new pink card. So even then, the re-registration process, as I've already indicated, shouldn't have posed an unusual problem for a large number of people in the Muslim minority population on the western border with Bangladesh. In fact, among frontier communities, this was probably one of the better documented communities at the time. But registration officers, apparently acting on orders from superiors, refused to re-register people there and give them pink cards. Those denied new documentation not only included people who may have been poorly documented, but people who had graduated from universities, people who were working as civil servants, who had already gone through numerous background checks in addition to those that would apply to any other citizen in the country. Furthermore, people who submitted green cards were not issued with new pink cards, but were instead given a white card, which is a temporary registration card. As its name suggests, that card was never intended as a document for the purposes of identifying someone permanently residing in Myanmar, but only as interim documentation. Nevertheless, it was treated as a form of permanent identification for this now subordinated political community from the early 1990s up until 2015, when it was replaced with a new card regime. So in sum, the process of rendering stateless hundreds of thousands of people hitherto identified or self-identifying as Rohingya, now officially designated Bengali, inverted commas, was achieved not by complying with the terms of the citizenship law per se, even though the law's contents were in their general intentions, inimical to the interests of this population, but through their deliberate breach and selective application. Now, because Dayantar identity has surpassed citizenship to become the gold standard for membership in the political community Myanmar, the place of people once belonging to that community but now classed as non-national race groups is much more precarious than it previously was. And those people excluded juridically from the political community Myanmar, but living inside its territory, now have to find a way back in. And the only way for them to do that politically, which is to say collectively rather than individually through making legal applications on their own merits and saying that they have what is required to be classed as citizens, to do that politically, the only way to do it is to submit to the politics of domination inherent in the National Racist Project and insist that they also are Dayantar. And here we come to the nub of the problem. Now, from a black letter point of view, this insistence is in fact perfectly sensible. The 1983 procedures on citizenship that followed the law in 1982 actually state that apart from those groups already nominated, quote, many other races and ethnic groups that are Dayantar remain, unquote. In other words, 135 isn't the upper limit. The law, the procedures themselves make that clear. The citizenship law also stipulates that the cabinet has the authority to determine whether or not a group is a national race. That is to say, people seeking to participate in the political community Myanmar are legally encouraged, if not compelled, to make claims that they too are national races. And the law implies that a procedure exists for them to submit those claims, to have those claims adjudicated and administered and decided upon. Accordingly, Rohingya advocates claim that their community identity is that of a national race. And it is this claim specifically, I would argue, that has caused them to be the targets of so much anger from the members of other communities residing in Myanmar who are determined to deny the validity of that claim specifically, and that to deny it before it is ever given any form of formal consideration. Yet the vehemence with which Rohingya activists are met on this point is made all the more remarkable by the fact that Rohingya aren't questioning the National Racist Truth Regime, as I am. In fact, they are embracing it. they don't oppose the truth regime itself, but merely the proposition that Rohingya are not included among the national races. By engaging the state on questions of entitlement according to its own exemplary term for identification of the political community, rather than critiquing or challenging it, they rehearse the state's own logic. By acquiescing to the national race truth regime, they recognize that the surpassing symbolic and juridical power of Dayantha is at once their problem and also their potential solution. And so we have the history wars with which some of you may be very well familiar already, but wars that are fought according to a single set of rules laid down by this national racist truth regime. For to write history for the purpose of establishing the existence of Rohingya is to acknowledge and rely upon the official history writing project and the claim that Dayantha also exist. So advocates of the Rohingya then work inferentially and establish their credentials consistent with the conditions that attach to being members of national races in official histories published since the time that the National Races Project really took off. They engage in box-ticking exercises. National races have lived in the territory now designated Myanmar anterior to 1823. Well, so have Rohingya, their advocates say. National races lived together amicably prior to the British invaders' arrival, and so did Rohingya. National races fought together against the imperialists from the time of their incursion until the time of national independence, and so also Rohingya laid down their lives for the independence struggle. Thus, the alternative history that Rohingya advocates articulate is not the counter-history of subjugated knowledge of a dominated community that we might suppose it would be, again, a nod to Foucault, because although it aims to bring out historical contents that are buried and disqualified and contest some premises of the truth regime, it does not question the foundational premises of the regime itself or its underlying truths. Far from releasing anyone from the Dayantha truth regime by virtue of their articulations, Rohingya advocates ultimately also reproduce it. In closing, I would argue that the good news, such as it is that the national race idea is not especially beguiling. That's my position, anyway. It persists because, primarily because of its coercive force, because of the manner in which it functions to dominate and exclude politically. Under these circumstances, it seems to me, a special responsibility falls to people who aren't beholden to the politics of Dayantha, like myself and other scholars working on Myanmar, to ask questions of the national racist truth regime, to interrogate it. This responsibility extends beyond pointing to specific arrangements to deny Rohingya a place in the political community. That type of work is already being done. And rightly condemning the gross and manifest abuses of human rights that people who identify or are identified as Rohingya suffer. That work also is already being done. It extends also to recognizing and explaining how ultimately Myanmar's problem is not a Rohingya problem, as some scholars have characterized it, but a national racist problem. That is to say, the surpassing status of Dayantha itself is the problem. Thank you.
Okay, I have a whole list of questions here, but I, rather than launch right in, I'd like to make sure we leave plenty of time for you as the audience to engage our speakers. So let me go ahead and open the floor and allow anybody who has questions, or we ask that you keep the questions succinct and have them actually be question marks, our questions ending in question mark rather than long statements. But we'll turn the floor over to you. And remember, there's a microphone that is circulating, so if you wait for a second and pick the microphone up so we can catch your full question, that would be great. You want to start us off?
My benefit, I'd appreciate just a brief.
Yeah, tell your names.
Name and if there's any affiliation or anything that
you can. Oh, okay. I'm Nancy Florida in the Department of Asian Languages and Cultures, and I teach about Indonesia. Okay. So I had a question for Matt. And this was, you had the three possibilities of reconciling this contradiction. And I wondered if. You could say more about the third one, the political. Mm-hmm. And if you think that the political is actually, indeed, if there are forces politically behind the communal violence, or because you didn't come down on any of these three, so I wondered if you would talk about the third. And then I have to leave early, so but I'll.
Go ahead.
So, I mean, the real question you're asking is there really a dark force behind the violence, I think?
Dark forces. Are factions in the military or
sure.
Certain groups that...
Yeah, it's a hard question to answer. We don't know what's happening internal to the military or within the different political parties. We get things that are kind of glimpses, and it's hard to tell. We know in specific cases. So in Mandalay in 2014, we know that there was mob violence, which followed an accusation that two Muslim men who owned a tea shop had sexually assaulted a Buddhist woman. We know that later, after that became a major issue around which violence was mobilized, that accusation was false, that woman had been paid to do that, that she and her partner had fled to Thailand. So we know that there was someone was nefariously organizing something. We don't know who paid her, we don't know, right? We know that this other case that I mentioned, we had looked at these sort of four cases where there'd almost been violence and then there wasn't. We know that someone was systematically posting information on Facebook and distributing sort of broadsheets detailing a plot by one group to attack another. That seemed to be an organized work to foment violence. But again, we don't know who those people were. And then there are other examples like this. We also know that, in my experience, that people who are better minds than I about Myanmar politics, who are more involved in this sort of inter-party politics, they will persistently make the argument that there is some kind of dark forces organizing things. So in their assessment, the answer is clearly yes, but no one has found a smoking gun. So I would not put in print that I have evidence that I don't have. I do think, you know, and so what can we do with these kind of rumors? I think there's one way to handle them, which is the position that the International Crisis Group has taken, which is an influential organization doing sort of up-to-the-minute political analysis about Myanmar. And their position has been that there is no smoking gun, and that these are the kinds of stories that people tell themselves because they feel uncomfortable with what's happening. It's a way to say this violence is not of our community. And I should say that the most common sort of version of this is that after there's been a riot, people from that area will say there were a lot of outsiders who were involved. There were people we don't know came into this area and did this. And there are a couple examples on this map. Some of these are all in a row, the light blue ones, I think, started in Natalin. Yeah. The light blue ones, this is along a road, right? And so the light blue ones all happen on the same day, the same 2 days. And the story is that a group of men on motorbikes came through one by one all of these locations. And so I've heard, you know, about those. Oh yeah, this was organized, this was all outsiders, so who paid them, who did that, right? Now, you can also say it's probably true, you know, certainly in Maitila, people say that it was outsiders, but also, I did a lot of interviews in Maitila, a lot of people from Maitila participated in that violence, so it's never either or. And so it would help you say, okay, my neighborhood, my city is not this awful city that, you know, was the site of this massacre. It was outsiders. That's a better way to handle that. I don't think, that might be the case for a lot of people. I don't think politically that's very helpful, because insofar as we dismiss and sort of debunk these arguments out of hand as conspiracies, then we're undermining, in a sense, an important political argument, which is if this violence is being mobilized, you know, in the strong version of the argument, it's being mobilized by a faction within the military, but all the way just down to the weak version, yeah, there is one party that has benefited up to this point more than another by these arguments. You know, then we undermine people's ability to use their political commitments to the NLD as a way then to persuade them to be involved in something that they may have less concern for, sort of pluralism, interfaith harmony, the kinds of things that international funders are happy to back, but don't necessarily have the same purchase yet. Sorry, that's a long answer, but that's the best I could do.
Nick, did you want to comment on that at all?
I would just say, by way of a quick reference to one of the other articles, there's only one article that really does come down firmly on that question. That's the Bang Thinking and Sumon Zhang article. and using contentious politics literature. They don't have any more sources or any more information than anybody else does, but through that lens, they make a...
Just get a little closer.
Yeah. Through that lens, they do make an argument that there was an alignment between elite forces in the military with particular political interests and influential monks at the time, and that through brokerage between those two groups, violence was enabled. So of all of the papers in the issue, that's the one that I think does address that question directly, because they have a process-oriented analytical approach.
Please.
Let me ask about the inverse of that, those situations where you might expect but do not actually reach violence. Where are you on figuring out what factors might be at work to damp down the violence or actually prevent it or stem it once it begins so that it doesn't reach a sort of a climax of high levels of violence?
I'd encourage you to look at our paper. It's called Failed Riots. Came out a few months ago, so that will have the more complete answer. The first thing to say is I don't think anyone has done systematic research on this. We encountered a lot of the sort of just so what if stories while we were doing our other research, and it seemed worth following up on, so we followed up on it. But it was only four. We had limited time. We had no sort of model that we were testing against. So what we did was we spoke with people who had been involved in, they felt that they had been involved in working to prevent the violence, and we got their analyses or the analyses of people kind of around them. It was also very hard research to do because many of these issues are still alive. So, you know, in the case of the boys who had a fight, that boy is still dead, and his family is still unhappy about it. And so if we, you know, we had to be very careful showing up and asking questions about this because it makes something that has been sort of let to rest for the moment come back up. So we had to be very careful when we published the paper we wanted to make it possible for everyone to guess multiple parts of the country where this stuff could have happened, because we didn't want anyone to be able to triangulate it and then go back and ask questions, because that would put us at risk. Some of the things we did notice was that, and the thing that I felt that we had the ability to make a strong argument about, was the importance of people who have developed reservoirs of kind of trust and authority, connections, social capital, whatever lens you'd like to put on it, in those areas through other kinds of work. So often people who are not those who are necessarily explicitly held up as peace builders or interfaith activists, but someone who's been involved in rebuilding after, you know, a natural disaster, who's been a patron of a religious organization, these kinds of things. These are the people who are then able to then play kind of negotiating roles, act quickly, command responses, have convening power, the kinds of things that you might imagine to have been necessary is one. And the other one is the availability of certain arguments. And so the availability of certain arguments. So the availability of arguments about sort of shared fate, communities of fate, that we will all be harmed equally. So in an area, the case where the boy was killed, that was actually in an area where most of those people are squatters. Now, the way that the law works, and Nick will know way more about this than I, but if your home is burnt, you then lose title. You can lose title to your land after a fire in urban areas. And certainly if you're a squatter, then your only claim to the land is your presence there. And so the argument there that was made was, look, if this becomes an issue, you know, and it escalates and our homes are destroyed, we will all suffer because we will never get back here. And so the ability to make these kinds of arguments that resonate with people, these aren't arguments about plural society. These aren't arguments about the sort of normative importance of interfaith. These are arguments about we'll lose our claim to the land. It will undermine a party that we care about. Who is involved in this? Doesn't make sense given our experience. Wasn't your best friend in the eighth grade Muslim? Who is doing this? These kinds of things. So the kind of arguments that were available, the individuals that were involved, and then the last point was one that I already made, that we saw the way that these small issues were framed. And the framing in religious terms is what enabled new people to get involved. And so this is, I think, starts to be the kind of stuff that Van Klinken is working on. But, you know, once a fight between two boys becomes or is made into an issue about religion, this is how a prominent monk from, you know, the larger city nearby is able to come and get involved. Because why would he have any business there except that it becomes a religious issue?
Nick, do you want to jump in there?
No.
John?
get into a comparative question. How can we look perhaps at Burmese Muslim relations in relation to Thai Muslim relations, particularly in regard to the question of citizenship within the self-defined nation?
I haven't done any comparative inquiry of this sort, although I've certainly entertained this question with colleagues who are working on Thailand. So I'd be speaking out of turn if I said anything at length about it, but it's an interesting and important question. There are certain parallels that lead to opportunities for fruitful comparison, but I think there are also significant differences in the two cases. And one I would point to, going precisely to my own paper, is that as far as I'm aware, there's no comparable notion of political identity in Thailand of the sort that we find with Dayantha. Right? There's the idea of the Thai nation that dominates a lot of the political language there, such that there's a concern for, at least insofar as I understand it, a certain homogenizing project and assimilatory project, and a recognition of difference for the people in the South. But aside from that, I think the absence of a comparable Dayantha-type truth regime means that the dynamics there are very different. Secondly, as far as I'm aware, even among the people in Bangkok and nationalists in Thailand who might object to the politics of the southernmost provinces, nobody disagrees or disputes the fact that the Muslim minority population there is entitled to live there, whereas that's precisely one of the bones of contention in Myanmar. These are Bengalis. Many of them are illegal migrants. There were a few of them, but they've multiplied at such a rate that they couldn't have just been living there all along. Rather, they're using various techniques to nefariously cross the border and come into our country because Bangladesh is so full. So why would people want to live there? Obviously, Rakhine State has much better conditions. So this narrative dominating a lot of the language around the conditions on the western border of Myanmar has a very different character and content to that in comparison to the conditions in Thailand, where the dispute is essentially over whether or not those southernmost provinces are entitled to a degree of autonomy that currently they lack because of the unitary nature of the Thai state. But Alan, you might have.
I agree with that. There are some parallels in terms of the language and the way that things are framed, right? So the idea of being, a true Thai is I think it resonated to me when you're talking about sort of Dayantha being more important than formal citizenship. So. Then the language used to talk about, particularly Southern Muslims, the pejorative term is "kak visitor," right? You're not truly Thai, even though they don't dispute that they that they lived there for centuries and that they don't have right to territory. There is this sort of sense that they're outside the sort of the normal normative bounds of what's considered truly Thai, the access to the rights and the privileges that come with being truly Thai. So, those differences you mentioned are there and are important as well. Other questions?
I'm Richard Tucker. I'm an environmental historian with a background in colonial India. While we're at these comparative this question of comparison with other Southeast Asian countries, let's go to Sri Lanka. And as you were talking, maybe this is most directly pointed to you, Matt, I'm not sure. Sri Lanka, during the years of the Civil War, the combat-related communal stereotypes of Buddhists and Hindus and Muslims. And I don't know if anybody has really probed that Myanmar-Sri Lanka comparison or possibly continuity.
I would want to be careful because I don't know a lot about Sri Lanka. And the period that you're referring to, I really don't know about. I guess two things to say. The first is in the In the contemporary era, the concerns about the rhetorics about risks of Islam to Buddhism in Sri Lanka, I understand to be very similar. And then the second is that there are material connections between religious communities in Sri Lanka and in Myanmar. Now, of course, those go back a very, very long ways, and those are, we should not, you know, see them as only turned toward sort of Islamophobia. They're there for plenty of good reasons, but there are also connections between some of the more prominent sort of, I don't know if right, sort of left-right politics is the way to describe it, but the more hardcore anti-Muslim political elements in Sri Lanka and those in Myanmar. They visit each other, they provide trainings for each other, they cite each other, and so those are, you know, those are things that are helping play out. And I guess maybe I'll say a third thing. The thing that's important about that, I think, is that we need to see these things as being mobilized in the contemporary era. That there's a lot that's available from the colonial era, and I think the socialist era, some of the stuff that Nick is helping us see the development of, but that it's being made and remade now. And so these connections that have long, long histories of connection between Myanmar and Sri Lanka are being turned in directions that enables new kinds of things. And so it's the historicity of this stuff is extremely important, but it doesn't presume that we'd have to end up where we are. It's stuff that's being made out of available material.
Yeah, I think that question in some ways goes to a kind of maybe a geopolitics of communalism and Buddhist ethno-nationalism in the current period. A lot of the publications that I've seen by the communalist forces in Myanmar, the language they use, first of all, is one of the Western gates or the Western opening. It's the expression which is used, and we need to guard the Western opening against the incursion of Muslim forces that are determined to overwhelm us. And so they have these maps that portray the condition of Buddhism in the Southeast and South Asia and the remaining regions where the predominance of the population are Buddhists. And the argument is that that's the front line for the fight for the survival of the Sasana, the Tathana, in the Burmese pronunciation that Matt was referring to in his presentation. Also this idea that, well, if there are no more Buddhists, then the Tathana also is gone with it. It's eradicated. There's no supramundane force that will sustain it on its own. It requires that community to be sustained. And so then, of course, the alliance with the monks in Sri Lanka, the Bodhubala Sena, of course, and others becomes a significant part of the story. Empirically, becomes a significant part of the narrative of the defense of the Sasana against the incursions of the Muslims. I think it's even crept into some of the language at the moment in Thailand, around Tamakai, which is at the temple in the north of Bangkok that's been besieged recent months, in fact. It's gone on for some time now by the current military regime there. And that's interesting because that language, I think, is unusual for Thailand in comparison to Myanmar and perhaps also Sri Lanka. I was going to say that also that there are a number of scholars who are looking at this issue specifically and thinking about how they can do comparative work. So on Myanmar, one of Matt's co-authors, Matthew Walton, who has just published a very good book on political thought and Buddhism in Myanmar, is in conversation with one of our colleagues, Ben Schonthal, who studied at Chicago, but is now at University of Otago in New Zealand, who has also just published a book on Buddhism and law in Sri Lanka. And I think Duncan McCargo, a scholar, expert of Thailand especially, and a prominent Southeast Asianist, is also taking an interest in how it might be possible to engage in more comparative work on this issue. So keep your eyes open. I think in coming years you'll see more work done by people who are very well familiar with the country cases as well.
John Holt at Bowdoin also is. He gave a keynote about this at the Asian Studies Conference last week. He works in Sri Lanka mostly, but is now looking at comparisons between Sri Lanka and Myanmar.
All right. Hi, Dominic Nardi, University of Michigan. So Matt talked a bit about the NLD and the NLD's response to these protests and how it's adopted the it's purporting to adopt the counterterrorism frame that the military has tried to push. There's obviously a lot of commentary criticizing the NLD for not having a more forceful response against the violence. But you know, on the other hand, when Aung San Suu Kyi has talked about this, it's always been very controversial. And even when she criticized Buddhists for engaging in violence, you know, I remember a few years ago, and it sparked protests in the street and people burning her picture. And so I guess I'm wondering, what are the government's options, or I should say NLD more specifically, what are their options, and would they, do you foresee a possibility of a more forceful response against the violence, or is this just, because I guess my concern is I don't really see a way out. If they were to criticize anti-Muslim violence too harshly, then there could be a backlash. But on the other hand, you know, right now it looks like acquiescence. So is there a way out of this, or you know, what? How do you? And maybe that's asking you to be fortune tellers, but you know, it's Burma, so.
Who wants to go? Like, okay, the junior scholar goes first. It's a
it's a flat table.
It's a very difficult question. Obviously, the NLD does not have control over the military. So, what could the NLD have done to influence in material terms the conduct of the military in Rakhine State in response to the attacks of 2014? Structurally limited options for sure. The same problem is playing out in Kachin State and Shan State. NLD is seeking to manage a peace process, but it really can't make commitments that are binding on the military. And so you will see a regularity, and this was the case before as well, but under the previous government, that there seemed to be a temporal correspondence between key moments, key meetings, promises made by one side or another, and then an aggressive action by the Tatmadaw. Airstrikes, attacks on a you know, hilltop base controlled by the Kachin or the Shan armed groups. So, one, you're absolutely right. She has limited options to reign in the military. My concern is more sort of the individual allegiances of those people who we were discussing a moment ago, who are crucial for working against violence, who are crucial for sort of mobilizing alternative positions, who are the only ones who can make an argument to say, for example, I am equally, and I have demonstrated my equal commitment to the promotion of the Thathana, the maintenance of Buddhism into the future, and I don't think that the best way to do that is support for an organization like Mawatha, that it's best accomplished and by other means, that we can both promote the Thathana and live peacefully with our neighbors, that it's maybe convenient to have a Muslim neighbor who is willing to butcher cattle because I myself am partial to beef curry. It's better to be a Buddhist who doesn't have to do the killing. These kinds of arguments, which people make and are persuasive in some context. The NLD can do a lot outside of attempt to rein in the military, and they can also participate in the game of trying to corner the military, right? The U.S. government is seeking to reestablish military-to-military relations. These guys probably know more about it than I do, but I would assume that Cobra Gold, the annual counterterrorism exercises that the U.S. holds with Thailand, I would assume that in the next few years, the Myanmar military will participate in those things. They've already been observers, stated not to be there for military training purposes, but you know, it seems that that will, you know, okay, now reading, sort of predicting the future, I would expect that stuff to happen. Right now, the NLD has the ability to put the Tatmadaw in a difficult position vis-a-vis its military aims, its desires, and in a way that makes it hard for the Tatmadaw to then, so NLD's cornered, but they've kind of allowed themselves to be cornered. The last thing I'll say is that there are many other things that are happening that the NLD does have the power to rein in, and we're seeing a little bit of it. So, and this is actually, at the end of January, there was an assassination of a prominent Muslim lawyer who's also been a key advisor, legal advisor to the NLD, Kony, who was shot in broad daylight just after he stepped off of his plane and was waiting for a taxi at the international airport in Yangon. And he was, and this is back to the earlier question, which Professor Florida left, but, you know, he was paid by a group of three or four retired military officers. So who, you know, and where did they get their money? A lot of money changed hands for that assassination. Now, there was a huge outcry against that assassination. And that was, in my mind, a kind of re-flourishing of this idea that this stuff is all being used to undermine the NLD. And that's good. I was very worried that that was going to be a thing that happened and just happened, and there wasn't a negative response to it. And if there was not a negative response to that assassination, we'd have to be very worried about the sort of continued salience of these political concerns. What's interesting is that the lady did not attend his funeral, and she said very little after his death. And I think she regretted that, because then a month later, there was a second service for the family at a prominent restaurant where a lot of these events tend to happen. And she did attend that, and she made some remarks there. But it was a little bit, and it was a month later. And those are the kinds of moments that, you know, a strong statement of how much he had given to the country, a strong backing, would have been a strong backing to a lot of people who were using that moment to remake this argument about the politics that is behind these anti-Muslim concerns. And she let that pass, and that was a missed opportunity. And those are moments, right? And then the continued sort of circulation of hate speech, these prominent guys who have funding, right? There's more than enough out there to go after these kinds of things, and that's within their control. So you're right, they're in a tough position, but there's plenty that could be done that is not being done.
Nick, I'll leave you with the last word.
Oh, okay. Well, I was going to offer that if there is anyone with a remaining question, you could do that instead. Otherwise,
yeah, you come up afterwards. Yeah, I think we're out of time. So if anybody has remaining questions, we can come up at the end.
I perhaps won't answer Dom's question directly, but let me just say that with the election outcome in 2015. Some people had a somewhat celebratory mood that apparently the religious extremists and the communalists had miscalculated and had underestimated overestimated their strength, in as much as the NLD was overwhelmingly successful around the country. Individuals and groupings that were aligned with the ethno-nationalists and the communalists were, for the most part, unsuccessful, with Rakhine State being the one exception. But even there were some surprising outcomes. For anyone who's interested in Rakhine State, a volume that I edited last year called Conflict in Myanmar, which is one of the ICS volumes that was alluded to at the beginning of the talks, has a very interesting article in it by a Rakhine academic, Dr. Thantun, who's at the ANU as well. You may like to look at that. In any case, one of the points that he makes, and a couple of other scholars in that piece make, is that we ought to be cautious to say too soon that 2015 really was such a loss for the extremists, for Mabatha, the Myobatha, Sasana, group which has been at the forefront of the Buddhist nationalist position in recent years. And one of the reasons for saying that is that they achieved quite a lot in 2014, 2015 that it will take some time to push back against and undo. Some of the changes were changes in the political atmosphere, in the narratives around political life and action in Myanmar in the current period. Other were formal institutional changes. So let us not forget that they succeeded in passing these four laws for anti-conversion, for requiring Buddhist women who are registering for marriage with non-Buddhists to go through a rather complicated process before they were married, for population control and for monogamy, although the last law has had rather unexpected consequences, as is sometimes the case with laws of this sort. And in the current period, there are moves to make legislative changes to push back some of the most egregious features of those laws and to steadily effect some sort of institutional change that may give NLD more opportunities to speak and act in ways that some people would like it to act on this issue. But it does seem that for the foreseeable future, they will be constrained by a lot of these politics. And I would also just come back at the end of the day to my own piece, as one sometimes is wont to do, and say that, well, at the end of the day also, the NLD is a subscriber to the National Racist Truth regime, along with every other political party and dominant grouping in the country. And from my point of view, as long as that Dayantha Truth regime dominates political thought and practice in Myanmar, there will be recurrent problems of this sort, whether or not they appear in precisely the form that we've seen in recent years or otherwise.
Excellent. On behalf of the Center for Southeast Asian Studies and the Weiser Center, please let me thank you for coming, and please join me in thanking our two distinguished panelists.